How many of you out there have been kidnapped? How many of you out there are homeless? How many of you out there are still homeless today? Well, for me, I've been kidnapped and I'm still homeless today, and I'm doing everything I can to fight it, which is why I'm going back to the employer that already offered me and I already accepted full-time work. But before I do that, because I don't know any drug addict that does this kind of stuff, I just thought I would tell you about a story that really happened to me. And I'd like to put more time on it, but chances are I'm going to die anyway, as I have a 16 times greater likelihood of dying for already surviving homelessness for more than a year. It's just a fact. But here's a story that's actually true, and it's really worth listening to. Here it goes. This is a picture of me right before I was kidnapped. It was the day I was kidnapped. It was me outside the library. Now, does that look like somebody on drugs, or does that look like somebody cold, homeless, and downtrodden, hoping beyond hope that they'll be okay? Well, for me, it was the latter. And I don't have any pictures of my being kidnapped because the kidnappers stole my phone. What I want to tell you about that is I'll tell you what my mother asked. The only question she asked when I came back from surviving the kidnapping, she said, "Nathan, where were you when you decided to go get kidnapped?" The answer to that is I was a few blocks away on Washington Street at the Taco Bell close to the state capitol in West Virginia when a friend asked me, someone that I had went on a date with 8 years ago, I knew I was safer getting in the car with them than I would be with my mother, because that person had not tried to kill me and my mother had. There's not much I really want to say about the kidnapping in general, except that I was told I was going to die. I was going to die that night. I would be dead by the end of the night. And if you've ever been told that, then you get real serious with God real fast, and you just kind of accept chances are likely you probably will be dead. That's what I had to experience. And here's what I want to say. If there's ever someone you love, maybe you're not sure if they love you, but if you ever have the chance to kind of inflate their stock price and make them more than they are, I don't have any regrets on doing it myself, because it kept me alive that night. It's something I think of every single day. And I did. It was, I had that, man, you have something called your fight or your flight response, and then you have one more called freeze, and that's when you can't. When you are in the back seat of a vehicle and the doors are locked, maybe you're tied up, maybe you can't say anything, maybe you're going to be driven down to a dirt road where there's going to be four men that are going to jump you until you can't be jumped anymore because you passed on to the next life. That's kind of what I was facing. So while everybody is still not caring about me now, that was what was going on in March of 2023. Now, I want to skip ahead and I'm going to change the picture. There's not going to be many pictures changed here, but I'm going to change one and I'll show you where I was in June of 2023. After I had escaped the kidnapping and came back to Colorado with less than $10 in my pocket and bloody feet at the Greyhound station in West Virginia when I left West Virginia for the fifth time. Now, in this country, if you have a family that doesn't love you and is morally bankrupt, the federal government is still there, and the federal government says, if you have nowhere else to go and you have HIV, here's where you could stay. You could stay somewhere like the Aurora Motel. But nobody told me I had to be there before the lobby closed at 8:30, and I got there about 8:35, 8:40, somewhere in there. I had been spending the day trying to get a cell phone to work, but I only had a tablet that was dead. When I arrived, I really needed to be in that motel room to charge the tablet. I really needed to drink tap water from the sink. I had no money. I had no SNAP. I had nothing available except the promise that this hotel room would be there. And when I got there, it was already too late because nobody told me I had to be there before the lobby closed. So here I am on the outskirts of Denver, close to the Aurora section of suburb of Denver. And I realized I can't stay here tonight. Obviously, if you can't tell, this is a very crime-ridden place, and I knew I wasn't safe to stay there outside at all. What was I going to do? Well, I had to make it back some way to somewhere of safety, a safe refuge. The only place that I knew was the man of my dreams' apartment. It wasn't too far from here, but I had only been there once before in November. I went back and took this picture the next day after when I still tried to get in and still was unable to get into this place because the management there is corrupt. But when I went there the night before, I had nowhere else to go, and I went on top of Colfax Station, which is nearby, and I just had a talk with God, really. I was up there in the darkness with the rain clouds and the wind, and he said, you've been everywhere in this town you've been wanting to go except for that one place, that one special place, the most important place in the world. And he just said, you need to go there. You need to try. Just go ahead and start moving, and I will lead you there. And so I did. I started, it was at this point getting late at night, cold and windy, rainy. I had already been homeless for over, since September. This is now June. And I didn't know what to do, except I knew I needed to try to find shelter. I needed electricity, and I needed water. I needed a safe place to rest my head so I wouldn't get beat up, mugged, and robbed of anything else I had left, that tablet. So I did. I actually started making one foot in front of the other, and I walked, and I walked, and I walked, and I walked. And when I got there to the most important place in the world, he was outside. He was underneath a covered porch. It was raining. He had a newspaper in his lap. And the sight of me and the sight of him was something else. Now, I don't have a picture of me of what that man saw when he looked across the street and saw me in the pouring rain, but it's pretty much just like this one. Because I'm the best, I have a good representation and memory of what I looked like that night. And it was the only night that I actually felt that I was at full strength, or at least matching him on his level. What happened after that? Well, I got what I needed. Let's put it that way. I got some closure, and I got a place to stay. It wasn't even in his apartment, but it was still in that building. And I got water and electricity. Water was not ever available at my father's house when I was homeless earlier this year, but it was there. I got closure, and I got what I needed and the strength to go on. And I know what you might be thinking. Something like this would never happen to my children or my family. We go to church. We're doing Christmas pageants. We're always involved in the community. We're doing things like that. Well, you know what? Unfortunately, the same thing was true in my family. We were just like that too, and it still happened. It still happened to his family too. So when I say I'm the leader of my family, it's because I am. And when I say that the family message this year is stronger together again, it is. And if I say there's no place that far, it's because I know. When I close my eyes,
always there when I close.